Okay, party people, this is Michele Lamberti speaking. Welcome to a new game of the day. This one is going to be out of our series, to call it this way. I will show you a game that I played a week ago against a slightly stronger opponent. I played this at my local chess club. And I wanted to show you this game because it echoes some themes that we were speaking in the last videos about. You will see an infiltration, you will see the themes of king safety. You know, my king was safe, his wasn't. And I was playing white, and my opponent with black was somebody called Apple. I didn't play against him, I didn't know him, and I didn't prepare for him because it's very hard to prepare. First of all, he is not in the databases, and at the tournaments that we are playing, it's not sure which opponent you you get. So I wasn't able to prepare for him. But so let's see the game. I started with d4. He played e6. Here after my knight to f3. And I went for a queen pawns attack here, kind of a London system setup. And here he played bishop d6. This is a good move, and I played a lot of games with it with white. And basically here I play everything. You know, I exchange. I play bishop to e5. I play e3. I play g3. You can play a lot of moves here. But I wanted to keep it a little bit simple, so I exchanged here. Another possibility would have been to just play e3 after the exchange. Basically, black here threatens the f4 pawn, and you have two ways to avoid this. You can play queen to c1, which is a good move. Okay. Or you can play g3 with the idea that you reinforce here, and the queen stays on the square. And if black trusts this one, you know, queen to b4 with check, you play knight to d2 if he takes, and you just basically you are giving up here a pawn, but you have massive development, and you have here your three minor figures out, and you will get this open line. So this is it's equal, but I think it's a little bit easier to play for white. So I wasn't afraid of this variation, but it was a Sunday morning, so I went for something a little bit quieter, and I exchanged here, and he took with the d pawn. You can do this because it reinforces here the c5 and e5 square. But okay, at the end of the day, this can be a liability. Okay, I played c3, reinforcing the center, and you don't have to play immediately c4. You can delay it here. And he went for f5. This was a little bit surprising for me. I know that a lot of this line is somehow fashionable at this club level. I mean, it's okay, but for me, and for white and for black, but it caught me a little bit off guard. But okay, so I said, okay, let's play again simple. He's regetting here this his bishop out, and trying to develop. He played knight to f6, which is the best square. I played knight to d2, and okay, the position is about equal. Here I played bishop to d7, which I think it's a strange move. Better move would have been just to play f6, you know, before you play with the with your bishops. Play with the knight first, you know, develop your knight first. And bishop d7, it blocks the d7 square for the knight if you somehow want to redirect it. And I thought that he was planning to play something like bishop d7 to c6, and then eyeing down here on this diagonal, because in this kind of a position where your opponent has played f5, you want to avoid that he plays f4. So this was one of the reasons I played e3. But in this kind of Dutch positions, you play g3, again making it harder to play f4, and then you play bishop to g2. So I thought, okay, he plays d7 because he wants to play his bishop to c6, and then having here this counterpart, which I think that it would have been a good idea. But okay, I thought, okay, attack b7, and let's see what happens. And I was pretty sure that he would play bishop to c6 and continuing with his idea, but he played b6, and this is a very weak move, because now here my bishop has this diagonal, and this already is a great piece. And yeah, you made a lot of pawn moves, and this guy is still weak. So I thought, okay, this is good for me. I thought, okay, I have somehow survived the opening. And I try to attack b6, because I wanted to see, okay, what is he up to? Does he want to play aggressive? Is he easy to scare? And he played knight to c6, developing. And okay, I continued with my plan. I played g3 here. A better move would have been to play the bishop on e6, where he would be a really great piece, taking out any rook c8 ideas. But okay, I played g3. I was a little bit played a little bit too fast here, but I wanted to play fast because basically the last game I lost some time. So okay, this was a 1.5 hour game. So both we had 1.5 hours for the first 40 minutes, and then 30 minutes for the rest. It sounds a lot, but when you have to calculate a lot of variations, it basically not really possible. So I thought, okay, let's play the first 20 moves reasonably fast. And okay, this was the explanation for g3. And yeah, he castled, and I played bishop g2. And position now is equal. No? And okay, he played now rook c8. I had to castle, and he played his knight to e4. And okay, this is usual stuff, it's normal. I exchanged, and I thought that he would play here the best move, which is to take with the f-pawn, fe4. But he, for reasons unknown to me, he played d to e4. And now c4 is a threat. Now, e6 is another weakness, and these pawns, you don't look good. And yeah, I mean, now this knight here reinforces c4, so the engine says that it's equal, but I think this is a little bit harder to play for black. And he went here for this idea. He played his knight to a5, harassing my queen. This leads nowhere. Okay, in this kind of situations, in this Dutch kind of structures and openings, with black, you have to play on the king side. You have to play some king side attack. He could have played g5, or the queen to f6. In this kind of structures, where everything is pointing on the king side, you have to attack on the king side. On the queen side, that's where I'm going to attack. So for me, it was clear that this attack here was going nowhere, and I played basically the best move here of the game. I played queen a3, and this is not easy for black. Again, you have these weak squares, these weak pawns. C4 is coming, and he played d5. And this is the best move. The problem is that now c4 becomes even more potent, because then if he doesn't take, I just take here these pawns, and then this pawn will be very weak. And if he takes, then I will get the diagonal, which we see later on in the game. So after he played d4, I just kicked the other knight out. The best move here is to play knight to b7, and I knew that this move here would be very bad for black. So I exchanged. He took with the rook. His idea is to attack c3. The problem is that if he attacks with all of his pieces, I can easily defend with all of my pieces, and he will get nowhere. And I saw that after this move here, rook f to c1, I can get my bishop back on this diagonal, and this will be another problem, because now black will lose a tempo to get the rook out of c4. He cannot occupy c4 forever, so basically I'm winning here a tempo. And okay, here comes another bad move. He plays queen to c8, and now after bishop to f1, he has to go back to c7. He still dreams of attacking here this pawn, but he's not developing his kingside attack, and this attack on the c-pawn is going nowhere. Now I got three pieces, and I got this diagonal. And okay, I played rook c2-2-1. The idea is simple, you know, just play c4 or see what he would do. He plays another bad move. He plays queen to b7. The idea is that he wants to make space so that the other rook can come to c8. But again, this is going nowhere. And now I have multiple threats. Okay, I played the normal c1, rook to ac1, and he doubled his rook. And okay, and basically this is here already losing here for black, because after this is another idea. Now I can play b5, and he will never be able to break free, because my bishop is here on a6. I have the open diagonal now, which is very dangerous. I can go to d4, and I can play c4. So I have basically three advantages, and he can do nothing. Those pieces are all, you know, cramped together. This attack is going nowhere on the c line. He has no kingside attack, and now I knew that my position was very good. And he played king to f7. The engine here wants him to play h6, which basically is a zero move. And believe it or not, this position is close to winning. This already is 1.5 better for me. And I played here the right move, and one of the moves, because I show you this game, I break open. I play c4. And the idea is that after taking, which is the best move, I play this one. I play bishop to c4. And this is now very strong, because first of all, this weakness here is permanent, or he has to lose some tempo at the diagonal. And I'm threatening a lot of things. And he played his king to f6, and this is definitely the losing move. He wants to get his king out of the bishop range. Somehow better move would have been this one here, but then still comes queen to d6, and king to f6 is most definitely a blunder, because now queen to d6, which was prepared a couple of moves ago, is even more potent, because the king now is in complete range, near range of the king, of the queen. And already black has no decent moves. He went for g6, but again, any move that you play here with black is bad. He played for g6, and I just continue my plan. Infiltration, getting your pieces nearer to the king, and compare this king safety to this one, and then you will see who is winning. And here he played king g5, and When we look at other variations, let me put it this way, I was very surprised because after this one, I was most definitely sure that I'm winning. The king is in a complete mating net, and I played the best move, a move that I'm very proud of. I played queen to g6, to g7, pardon me. My idea is to play h4, king to h5, only move, and then bishop e2 mating. And there is no good way out of it. This is, you will lose a house or you will get mate, checkmated. He played the best move, he played his bishop to b5. Now, it seems that my idea now doesn't work because if I play h4 and then king to h5, now I cannot play bishop to e2 because then black can take it. But I found that I can play this idea anyhow. So I didn't care for it and I went for this one. Now it looks okay, you know, it's all over and black has won. But now the problem is that, wait a minute, here, what's going on here? So the problem is that now the C line was open and I was able to capture on c7. And notice that my queen didn't only attack here and was building, mating it, but also was protecting c7. Now after this here, I just win an exchange. And the best move here would have been to just exchange the kings, the queens, and go for a lost ending, because after this I just pick up here the pawns. And here playing with the exchange down is completely hopeless. This is a completely winning endgame for me. But okay, he wanted to get checkmated, so he played queen to h6. And here comes another idea, another reason why I thought that exchanging on c7 was mandatory. I just play king, queen to f4, and this is a maiden 4. I misplaced it, I misplayed it, I played basically, I don't know, maiden 8 or something, but there is no way that the king is coming out here. He tried this one. H4 here is winning. But okay, I made the wrong pawn move, I made g5. This is a mate in 5. He took, and I guess, yeah, I should have played king g2 with the idea of getting the rook over. But okay, I wanted to play it simple. I had a little bit of a headache here and was a little bit cold at the chess club, so I said, okay, let's play it simple. This is over, this is completely winning. There's nothing that black will ever do, so just play on and make reasonable moves. And this is this position is beyond repair, of course. So I got here this good idea. I played the rook to c7, and now it's a mate in 5. Now after queen to h2, it's a mate in 6. Queen to g3. Black is just playing only moves. And okay, I mean, now even a blind man can see this is going to be a mate. He played on, of course, king h4. Queen captures on h6 with a check. And here he resigned. This is a mate in 2, because after a bishop h5, I just play queen to f4. And now after this one, you will see rook to h7, and this is mate. So I think this was a nice game played by me. For me, the astonishing thing was that in the analysis, to see that basically after this move, it's completely over. You know, maybe this is still somehow survivable, but this is most definitely over here. The engine says plus 3.5 for me. So this is basically losing. And this is really the idea. You know, you infiltrate, and let's look at another variation. This one here is interesting because I thought that has to go to I don't know, e8. But the problem is that, believe it or not, you actually win the black queen. So believe it or not, King to F to G5 is here the strongest moves, because if you play this one, then it just this check, I open up the C line and I win the rook. Let's look at it. So I take here, and this is completely over. I saw this and I thought, okay, he will play this move here, but then you still have, wait a minute, what's the, yeah, you still have bishop to e6, and I thought this is not playable in light of black just capturing on c2, but then you have bishop to d4 with a d5 with a discovered attack, and you win the queen, and yeah, this is hopeless. Yeah. And you just play something like this, and yeah, I mean, it's all variations here and give you a complete winning endgame. So, yeah, I mean, this is bullshit to play on. So, I mean, you should really study this game when it comes to infiltration. And there are a lot of tactical motifs here with the open and semi-open C line. What you should take out from this game is when you're playing for Dutch kind of an attack, don't attack on the queen side, but on the king side. And yeah, watch your king safety. Thanks a lot. Bye.